to another game of Warhammer 40,000. It's 1850 points, and we are back in Imperial territory here. So it's a bunker outpost on an Imperial Guard planet. Slightly overgrown. Some ruins here. Coming around, there's a perimeter fence, and that opens out into the forested area. Coming around, you can see the pathway that leads into the compound. There's the entrance, and then in this direction, sandbag defences, tank traps. Imperial Guard Bastion here, nice commanding position in the middle of the table. The old fire base as well on the left, and then some more bush and scrub as well. Nice piece of terrain, but it isn't Imperial forces fighting on here tonight. It is actually Eldar, and they will be taking on the Dark Eldar. It's a game we've been waiting a long time for. Well, this is the terrain that they are going to be clashing on tonight. Right, welcome to our 1850 points game. It's Eldar, and they are taking on the Dark Eldar. So two armies will clash together tonight. So I'll be in command of the Eldar this evening, and then James and Ben will be taking command of the Dark Eldar. And it's Ben that has some experience of Dark Eldar, so they're up for the fight. Dark Eldar, there are a mixed results from those. They've got a point to prove in this game. We'll see how well they do. They're taking on perhaps our toughest army, so it'll be a real challenge for them. So in command of this Eldar force is the Eldar Avatar. No upgrades there. And then the army's changed, so I have some spare points. So for 60 points, I've got another unit of troops. So a unit of Eldar Rangers, five of them. And then two more troops, two units of free jet bikes, no upgrades, just 51 points each for those two units. And then the warp spiders are in. And then there is a warp spider exarch there. And then a unit of flanking scorpions, 10 of them. You've got the exarch there, a scorpion's claw. And they'll be inside a wave serpent with twin-linked scatter lasers. And also Shrukan cannon, and then just a basic wave serpent transport here. I've actually paid the points on top here. We are going to use that as a twin link scatter laser. And then inside there is five fire dragons, and then there's an exarch there with fire shot and fire pike. And then heavy supports. The Wraith Knight is back, and he's got the sun cannon and scatter shield. It's a nice model. It's become a nice part of this Eldar force. And he'll be accompanied by two Wraith Lords, each of those with a Ghost Glaive, two Flamers, and a Bright Lance each as well. And it's a debut tonight for the Eldar Flyer, Crimson Hunter, and he's been upgraded to an Exarch, and he is carrying a Pulse Laser and then two Bright Lances as well. So well armed and skillful. We'll see how well this flyer does. Have high expectations of it. So that's the Eldar force lined up and ready to go. So we're going to move on to deployment now for these two forces and see how they clash. Be interesting to see, because we've never played against each other before. Eldar got some strengths to the army, but the Dark Eldar have some countermeasures to it, so we'll see what happens. So just to start off with there, you've got the second in command here, and he's the Archon's protected by four Incubi bodyguard, and they're inside the Venom here, and then he's armed with a Agonizer and a Shadow Field, and he's also carrying the Webway Portal. And then the actual army commander just here, he's with a bodyguard of six Incubi, and again he's armed with a Shadow Field and a Agonizer. And then for troops, 10 warriors, and those warriors, there's a Cyberite in there and a Dark Lance, and that's inside the Raider transport here, and that's got Grizzly Trophies and Splinter Racks. And just on the two Archons, a little bit of change for this game, just freed up some points. The two Archons there, each of those is armed with Haywire Grenades, just a handy little upgrade for them that we thought they may need after playing the last game. So Haywire Grenades, those two commanders there. Then coming across, you've got the Haywire Ladies. Two units of 10 Witches. They're all armed with Haywire Grenades. And then there's a Hecatrix in each. And she's armed with a Agonizer as well. Then for fast attack, you've got a unit of Scourges. There's a Haywire blaster in there. Solarite is armed with a blast pistol and combat weapon. And there is also a Heat Lance in that unit. A bit of a throwaway unit, but they've each time they've deep-striked and done their job, so pretty good game. Hellions, difficult unit to master, but there's 10 of those. And then there's a Heliarch in there. He's armed with Agonizer and Phantasm Grenade Launcher. And then the Reavers perform well in the last game. Just 9 of them, and there's an Arena Champion upgrade in there as well. The Ravager is back, and then the Razorwing Jet Fighter will be in the game as well. So there's the Force. They do outnumber the Eldar in this game, so it'd be interesting to see what happens. But the overwhelming weight of forces with the Dark Eldar, as far as infantry go. But we know the Eldar have got some very specialised units in there. It'd be interesting because of all the poison weapons in here clashing with the Eldar monstrous creatures. And also the clash of air power as the Razorwing will take on the debut Crimson Hunter in this matchup. So the scenario is big guns never tire. So there's 5 objectives in this game, and they've been placed on the table. Dark Eldar deploying here, so that's 12 inches in, and they'll be playing up the table in this direction. So the Dark Eldar deployment zone runs along here. And then on the other side, the Eldar will be at this end of the table facing in. So they'll be breaking into the compound. Now the objectives, the Eldar have placed one objective here, just at the entrance of the Imperial Bastion. And then there's one just tucked away in the woods here. And then coming around for the Dark Eldar, there is an objective just here behind the building. And there's one here behind the building as well, behind the old firebase, and one just on the right-hand flanks. There'll be 3 points each for those. And then also, in this scenario, you get a point for killing heavy supports. So the Dark Eldar are going to be hunting down the Wraith Knight and the Wraith Lords. And then the Eldar can try and take the Ravager and the Razorwing as well. So as far as hunting down Wraith Knights and Wraith Lords is concerned, the Dark Eldar are pretty much the best equipped for doing it with all that poison weaponry. But we'll see what happens. Dark Eldar are deploying first, and they'll go first unless the Eldar can steal the initiative. So we're going to move on to deployment now for these two forces in this classic clash. So deployment here for the Eldar. The Fire Dragon's just sitting at the back here in their transport vehicle. Just trying to keep out of angle the Dark Eldar. You'll see what I mean in a minute. The Avatar just in position with the two Wraith Lords, and they're looking to move out to that objective in the bunker there. Should be able to hold that one all right. And then just upstairs, infiltrating with the scouts, just taking command of the position here. Then coming around for the Dark Eldar, the Reavers are just in the woods, just biding their time, just holding their position there, ready to move out. And then one Raider just at the back, sitting on an objective. And then the Ravager here, just hidden at the moment, but look, some pretty good angles lined up for them. And then the Venom with the second in command, the Webway Portal, just sitting at the back. The rest is in reserve for both forces, so only half the armies have been deployed here, and the rest will come on and will no doubt liven the game up. So that's deployment done. So in reserve for the Eldar, the 2 units of jet bikes, they'll be coming on from reserve. The warp spiders will be deep striking. Scorpions will be out flanking. These guys are in the transport at the back of the table. And then the Wraith Knight will be coming on from reserve, and also the Crimson Hunter Exarch. And then for the Dark Eldar, these guys are coming on from reserve with the Army Commander. And then these 4 are in with the second in command inside the Venom. And the troops, they're inside their transport. 2 units of witches coming on from reserve. The Scourges, they'll be deep striking. The Hellions will be coming on from reserve, and then so will the Razorwing Jet Fighter. Wonder who will win this aerial combat. So we're going to move on now to turn 1. Let's roll up for the Eldar now. Get a nice six. No, we don't. So it's Dark Elder turn one. Coming up. So Dark Eldar turn one, the Reavers are on the move. We've swung around on the left hand side, 12 inches. And then just coming across, quite quiet at the moment. So the Ravagers just moved out into position to take on the Wraith Lord. And then coming around, the Venom has moved out six. Second in command has got out and he's in a position to activate that webway portal. Just gaining himself, or the army reserves, just that extra 18 inches up the table. So shooting for the Dark Elder on turn one. The Reavers have just boosted up a bit further, just getting themselves into position. And the Ravager fired ahead. They got a hit on the Wraith Lord, but he's passed that save, so there's no damage there. And coming around, the webway portal has now been activated, so the Dark Elder reserves will be able to pour out of that. There's no combats, there's no charges on turn one. It's pretty quiet. The two forces sizing each other up. So we're going to move on now to Eldar. Turn 1. So Eldar turn 1. The Avatar and the Wraith Lords are pushing ahead. They're advancing towards their objective. And then the Wave Serpent has gone up 12 here. I'm just looking to get a bit of fire going against the Reavers there and make a advance towards what could be a weak area. If he's got all of his stuff coming out of the webway portal there, then we might try and just go down this alleyway and take on the transport vehicle. And just up the top here, the scouts, rangers, are just going to stay where they are, happy to pick off targets as they come up. So again, quiet on this turn. It's what usually happens in our 40k games. So we're going to just do a bit of shooting now for the Eldar and see what we can do. So the Eldar shooting on turn two. The scouts fired down, the rangers fired down at the Ravagers, just trying to get some rending hits, but no damage done there. And then the Wraith Lords, instead of firing, we've decided just to keep them out of trouble, keep them alive, because we are vulnerable. So we're just tucking up behind the Bastion here, and with the Avatar as well. And then some nice effective shooting from the Wave Serpent. We're firing that as a twin-linked scatter laser, and it's fired through and caused two casualties on the Reavers. That's a pretty good game. But it's all going to kick off now. We're going to go into Dark Elder turn two. The webway portal is open. We'll see what happens as we move into Dark Elder turn two coming up. Right, Dark Elder movement on turn two. The Reavers have moved across 12 inches. It looks like they're going to try and blade vein the Rangers on top of the Bastion. The Flyer has arrived. It's come screaming on the table and is heading directly towards the Wave Serpent, so there's trouble there. And then the Warriors, looks like they've got out of their transport and just sitting on top of that objective, quite happy. And then around here, the Ravagers maintained his position, just looking out across the table. The Incubi and the second in command got back inside the Venom. Then from reserve, the Hellions have come out. They're just taking up position behind the cover here, just sort of watching, I think, to see what the Eldar are going to do. And then the two units of Witches have got out of the webway portal, and one of them shifting round to move on to this objective. I think the Witch is going to be key here, because they are troops' choices, and it'll be those that will try and hold on to these objectives. It looks like both armies really are prioritising securing their own objectives first and waiting to see where the opponent will bring on the weight of their force. So it's a cautious from both sides, which we weren't expecting. We're expecting both sides to pile into each other. So it's strategic at the moment. We'll see what happens. I'm going to do shooting now for the Dark Elder on turn two. So the flyer is fired down on the shooting phase here and got a penetrating hit. The serpent shield knocks that down to just a glancing hit, so that's saved us there. And coming around, the Reavers were here. They've blade veined over the top and managed to actually take out two of the Rangers on top there. No morale chance because they're fearless with the Avatar nearby. And the Witch is just shifting around a little bit more. They've ran these as well, and then the Hellions have moved also. So that is Dark Eldar turn 2 finished. So we're going to roll on and move to Eldar turn 2. We'll see what reserves arrive for the Eldar. Eldar turn 2, the Wraith Knight has arrived. He's just coming down the left hand side. He's looking forward to using the Sun Cannon. And then the Reavers here, the Wraith Lord's moved out and in a position to take that on. Take those on. Rangers staying where they are. And then the Wraith Lord and Avatar Kane are starting to move down this corridor as well. One unit of jet bikes has arrived. And then the Fire Dragons. In the transport, the transport's just moved up and it's got a view towards the radar. So the Eldar's starting to move in now towards the Dark Eldar. Spiders have arrived, landed here, that's where we wanted them to land. So they've ambushed the Ravager here, and then the Scorpions have outflanked and just sort of trying to deploy in a formation to protect the transport. There's haywire grenades around. I'm just going to try and keep the Wave Serpent alive, and the Scorpions have put themselves in a position to let off a volley of pistol fire at the Witches. They'll be quite happy to engage them in combat. Look, quite a lot of Dark Elder stuff there, though, so it's going to be interesting trying to take them on. So a lot of stuff going on now. Eldar units popping up all over the place from every angle. So we'll see how the Eldar do as they shoot and try and take on this Dark Elder force. Right, Eldar shooting on turn 2. It has been a tale of destruction here. Wraith Knight fired down at a unit of witches and has eliminated them. They are gone. Sun Cannon has caught them out in the open and wiped them out, so the witches are gone. The Reavers have been picked on a little bit. The Rangers took out one. But we haven't eliminated them, and we've got a problem for ourselves now. This unit is alive, and the Hellions are alive, and they're both armed with poisoned weapons, so you could see the downfall of this Wraith Knight. It's a bit of bad positioning there. The Wraith Lord's just sat where he is. Jet bikes have moved, and then a continued advance down the corridor here from the Wraith Lord and the Avatar. It's good shooting from the Wave Serpent, which has made a steady advance. That fired, it deactivated the Serpent Shield and has destroyed the Raider. Killed a warrior as well in the resulting explosion. And then the ambush from the Warp Spiders took out the Ravager, so it's sort of going according to plan here for the Eldar. Fire from the Scorpions has killed six of the Witches, but Ben passed two lookout sirs, so they kept the Hecatrix alive. We'll see what they're going to do. Probably hurl themselves at the Scorpions next turn. And then the Wave Serpent firing did a glance and a penetrating hit, but Ben passed two Flickerfield saves there. So Dark Eldar have been hit hard. Just moving the Scorpions here. We've got the battle focus rule. We fired the pistols and then we've just moved them 5 inches just to protect the transport, just aware of the haywire grenades that can be used. So it's been an effective turn from the Eldar. Just different ambushes taking place all over the board. So we'll see what the Dark Eldar can do in reply. We'll see what they can do. It's all about objectives. Dark Eldar are holding 3 of them. Thank you. turn three, and they have responded, certainly up for this game. The Hellions have stayed where they are. They're going to take advantage of those poisoned weapons and then probably charge in. But the Wraith Knight, it looks like Ben is ganging up on the Wraith Knight here. It is isolated out in this position. The Flyer's turned around and is making a direct approach as well. And then also the Reavers will give some fire support as well. A lot of poison shots are going to come in. We could see that Wraith Knight brought down, and quite early in the game as well. And then the Dark Eldar have orchestrated their own ambush. The Scourges have landed and just about within range with the Blast Pistol as well. And they're going to try and ambush and take out this Wraith Lord. So the Eldar are being hunted down here. And we're coming around. This position is a strong position for the Eldar here. Dark Eldar Warriors are going to hold position on the objective and shoot at the Warp Spiders. And now a combined assault against the Striking Scorpions. Four Witches are going to charge in, and also the second in command with his Incubi bodyguard. So it's going to be a real clash there, and the Dark Eldar could come out on top of this assault as well. So it's not a foregone conclusion. Eldar are making their moves, and Dark Eldar are counter maneuvering back. The army commander's turned up as well with his bodyguard. So that's a real mix at the moment. It's nicely spread across the table. We'll see how effective the Dark Eldar can be with their shooting in this turn. It could be pivotal. We'll see what happens. Just in the middle of Dark Eldar shooting here. The Flyer hasn't done any damage to the Wraith Knight, but the Reavers have just caused three wounds with their poison weapons, so the Wraith Knight's half dead. And Ben's just about to fire the Hellions here. Here we go. 20 shots. Freeze he wants. And then we are on fours to wound. This is a fair old amount there. Yeah, that's horrendous. This could be the end of the Wraith Knight. We're looking at 11 saves of 3 plus. I'm going to roll them one at a time for effect. Passed one, passed another, failed one, passed another, passed, failed. I've got 3 more rolls. Don't get a 1 or a 2. Passed. He's gone. The Wraith Knight's been poisoned to death. It's about the earliest I think I've ever had to remove the Wraith Knight, and it's very rare that he's even removed from games, but he's been caught out by a Dark Eldar. It's what they specialise in. That Wraith Knight is no more. That's a big kill. A lot of points eliminated, so the Dark Eldar are not out of this game yet. So Dark Eldar shooting on turn three. It's been effective. The Wraith Knight's gone. That's a big loss to the Eldar. This ambush hasn't worked out. He fouled in all respects here. The Wraith Lord is untouched. There's a risk. The Wraith Lord is going to seek to destroy that unit. Then coming around the other side, the Carbolite Warriors gave a good account of themselves. They fired through, killed 2 of the Warp Spiders, and they've bust morale and fallen back in this direction. So Eldar caused damage, and then in reply, the Dark Eldar giving a good account of themselves here. A couple of Scorpions have been brought down from firepower, pistol fire from these units. So we're going to go on to assaults now. There are a few. So assaults, the Dark Eldar piled in, and then with snap fire, The scorpions have brought down two of the witches. So the combat goes on, but it's pretty good snap fire in return. And then we'll see what happens here. Who's going to win? Incubi and witches against striked scorpions. Right, so we're going to get this combat here. It's quite a key one. So the highest initiative here in this key combat is the Archon. So he's on four attacks. He gets one for his weapons and then one for charging. So six attacks. So you're on threes to hit. Whoa, only half. And then you're on fours to kill. You know, saves allowed from this. Only one. Only one. So one scorpion's been brought down there. Then reply, it'll be the scorpion Exarch. He'll get a go. So we've done our Mandiblaster attack. We've actually done those, but Ben's passed all of his saves. Two saves down here are passed. One on him. And then the witch has got two four-up saves as well. So Mandiblasters have had no effect, which is a shame. The Archon's killed the first figure there. So the next initiative is the striking scorpion Exarch. And also the witches. So we'll do this Exarch here. He's going to try and kill some Incubi. So he's on two attacks. And his weapon. Freeze to hit. Both actually striking a weapon skill 5. Incubi weapon skill 5. Yes, they are. And so is the Exarch, so it's 4s to hit. He hasn't got 4s. He's got a 3, a 2, and a 1. So the Scorpion Exarch used to be a hero, but he's not anymore. He has failed to hit in combat. Now I'm going to go over to the witches. 3 attacks for the first witch. And it's 1 hit. And then we're going to roll up. Falls to wound. It's get a reroll because it's for the combat drugs. Yes, free up save. We've passed on a 5 and then the Hecatrix. So that is 4 attacks on the charge. She needs it's just 1 hit. It's falls to wound. Yes, so the Hecatrix brings down a scorpion. There's 2 scorpions down. And then the Incubi our initiative 5, and so are the scorpions. So we'll do that simultaneously. 4 Incubi on the charge is 12 attacks. This is going to hurt. This isn't good. The Incubi have hit here, the scorpions, all of the hits. There's 11 hits. And he's on freeze to wound. Oh no, the scorpions are gone. The scorpions, I think, have actually, yes, the scorpions have been wiped out. The Incubi have just cut the scorpions to pieces. Now we're going to strike back. Here, that's another deadly blow to the Eldar here. The Incubi have absolutely slaughtered the scorpions, completely wiping them out. There's no damage dealt. Ben passing all of his saves. The witches have survived and moved off. And the Incubi just moving around to threaten the transport here. So the scorpions came on. A little bit of an impact, but have paid a heavy price. So, Eldar with the initial impressive initially, but now the Dark Eldar have struck back and they've hit hard and dealt out some nasty damage. The Eldar on the back foot, surprisingly, very surprised. Key Eldar units have been taken out, but we'll see what happens. Eldar turn 3 coming up now. We'll see how they can reply. Still got strength on this side of the table, so it'll be down to securing objectives again. But that Eldar threat on the left hand side has been eliminated. And we move on now to Eldar turn 3 coming up. We'll see if the Crimson Hunter can arrive and save the day. I cannot wait to bring it on and see if it can make an impact in this game. Alright, it's an exciting game. It's move and counter moves from either side. So the hunter now becomes the hunted. The Crimson Hunter has arrived and is going to move straight off to take on the flyer. infantry's on. His first target is this razor wing fighter, jet fighter here. Wraith Lord's moved out to take on the Scourges, and then sadly the Warp Spiders have bust morale, so that's the end of them. They're falling back again. Jet Bikes just holding position. Second unit of Jet Bikes has arrived, just securing that objective. And then the Wraith Lord has continued his advance down the corridor, but the Avatar is going to fall back. He need to maintain a fearless bubble there. That's his job, to protect that objective and claim those, help the infantry units claim that 3 points. Continuing the steady advance here with the Wave Serpent, just going to lay down some fire into the Carbolite Warriors. And then this transport's not going to hang around there. We're going to move out in this direction and then probably continue to move here and put fire into the Dark Eldar from a further distance. So, yes, the Eldar have been hit hard, but they're not out of the game, that's for sure. There's still some good units on the table. It's a difficult one to call at this stage. We'll see how well the Eldar can bounce back from this setback. Right, so the Crimson Hunter Exarch is going to fire. So it's got a pulse laser. That's 2 shots. 2's to hit, so that's 2 hits. And then also 2... Bright Lances at 2's to hit. They've hit. So it's armor 10, it's strength 8, and with a special rule we get to re-roll our armor penetration against flyers, so the Razor Wing could be in a whole heap of trouble here. We seek revenge. That's the penetration roll. He's got a jink, so pressure on here. Come on, Ben, see if you can get 4 5-up saves. If he does, I'm going to buy him his dinner tonight. Here we go. 5 pluses.
Do not roll his dice.
5+. He stopped 1. 3 penetrating hits. They're at AP2. It is gone. It's a stubble 6. It's been brought down in absolute style. The Crimson Hunter has arrived and has made his mark. In his first game, first shot, his first victim. Mission accomplished. Next target. A new hero is born for the Eldar. The Crimson Hunter has come to the rescue. And that's the end of the Razor. Crashed and burned and took out one of the Reavers in the process as well. It could have been a lot worse. It very nearly hit that entire unit. So that's good going. We'll continue shooting for the Eldar. That's a good strike back. Each force at the moment just countering each other, knocking out units. Difficult one to call at this stage. All right, Eldar shooting them on turn 3. The Wraith Lord has taken out the Scourges, completely wiping them out. Vicious game. Units just cutting each other down. Very clean and efficient killing going on at the moment. The Crimson Hunter's taken out the flyer. That's gone. And then the Rangers firing down have killed one of the Reavers. The Avatar's just fallen back a little bit more. The Jet Bikes shifted a little bit just to increase their jinx. So Carbolite Warriors have been decimated by the Wave Serpent. The other Wave Serpent's just falling back, just staying out of trouble. So Eldar manoeuvring and counter-attacking here. There's no assaults at all on this turn, so we're going to go straight into Dark Eldar turn 4. Now, how will they reply? And how will they respond to the Eldar? It's a difficult one. We don't know how this is going to go. Perhaps the advantage now shifts over to the Eldar. It's gone backwards and forwards so far in this game. We'll see what happens. Eldar are in control of the skies, at least. Dark Eldar movement on turn four. The Hellions have fallen back, just heading back towards the Webway portal here. And the army commander and his unit just holding that position as well, with two of the witches just claiming the objective. A bit precarious there, only two witches left alive. Reavers moving out and looking to Blade Vein, one of the Eldar units. And coming around the other side, the Carbolite Warriors, only three of them left, just trying to desperately cling on to that objective as well. And then the Venom, second in command, has jumped inside and is moving off with his unit towards one of the Eldar objectives. But really now, looking at the Dark Eldar, it does seem they're on the back foot here, because their troops have been knocked down quite badly. So Eldar in the stronger position, but we'll see. See what the Dark Eldar can do on their shooting now, on turn four. Dark Eldar shooting on turn four. Hellions have just fallen back here. I'm just moving out a few inches. Same with the army commander. And coming around, Blade Vein attack from the Reavers here. Ben's using them well. They've taken out two of the Warp Spiders and Morale's Bust as well, so that's the end of them, sadly. Another unit's been taken out. Then coming around, Carbolite Warriors managed to get a penetrating hit on the Wave Serpent, but we jinx saved that. It's pretty quiet, really. Dark Eldar just trying to hold on to their objectives, but it's precarious for them at the moment. That's the end of their turn. It's now Eldar turn four, and the question is, who will be the next victim of this Crimson Hunter? We'll see. Eldar turn four, the Crimson Hunter's shifted around and has turned. He gets an extra 90 degree turn, so he's swept around the building and is facing off against the Venom. Really the only vehicle left to chase. The primary targets for it have been destroyed. So, but it can fly around and pick off units. Greyflaw's just tucked himself in here as a heavy choice. He'll be quite happy just to sit there. Avatar falling back. We're just consolidating objectives now. And something we thought we'd never see, jet bike versus jet bike. The two Eldar jet bike units, very weak, but together, we've got a chance here of shooting at and charging the Reavers. Wasn't expecting to do that, but that might be our best chance of catching them, because they're so fast. And coming around, the Wave Serpents now. Just transport vehicles, but horrendous firepower from these. We're just setting ourselves up to try and take on the Venom, or the contents of the Venom, if we manage to bring it down. And then the Dragons have got out, going to try and pick off the last of the Carbolite Warriors here. It's the Eldar now on the move, and it's the Eldar that are closing in on the Dark Eldar here. Dark Eldar have given a good account of themselves, have done well, but the Eldar sensing possible victory here. So we're going to go on to shooting now for the Eldar on turn four. Right, so the Crimson Hunter takes another victim. That's the Venom has been taken out. It's just a small target, but his mission accomplished there. And then a fire coming through from the Wave Serpents then took out three of the Incubies. Past Morale, she's still in the fight there. And then a shot from the Rangers on the roof took out one of the Hellions. Then over here, Ben passed about eight of his jinx saves and has survived all of the shooting from the Eldar jet bikes. There's going to be a good combat going on there. See who will win. And then the Fire Dragons have taken out two of the Carbolite Warriors. He's passed Morales. There's one Carbolite Warrior left. So that's all the shooting for the Eldar. We've got a number of assaults here. The Wraithlord's going to have a go at trying to charge that second in command. And then the jet bike assault here as well. So we're going to roll up for those. So the Wraithlord has failed to make it into combat there. So there's no combats at this side of the table. And then in a twist of events here, this second unit failed to make it into contact. So just three Eldar jet bikes have charged in. So Ben holds the advantage there. We also know that he gets to re-roll his wounds in combat, so he's definitely got the advantage. And we're actually saying that if he manages to beat this Eldar jet bike unit and then go and take on this one, the Eldar are lacking in troops. All they'll have is just those three Rangers on top of the bunker there. So the game is not over yet. This is going to be crucial. What seems just a small melee could have a massive impact on the game. So we're going to roll this up and see what happens. The Eldar hold the Dark Eldar in combat there. That could have been a lot worse. So that melee will continue. That marks the end of Eldar turn 4. We're going to move on now to Dark Eldar turn 5. Another development for the game here, the Hellions have been kept alive and realizing that they've got these poisoned attacks, range 18, two shots each. So they're going to go on the hunt for the Eldar heavy support. The Wraith Lord could be in trouble here, so a lot of shots going to be pumped out. So Dark Eldar got a small force left, but they're not out of this game. If they make a comeback, then it's going to be quite something to behold. It's moving into combat there. The second in command fancies his chances against the Wraith Lord as well with that poison weapon. Not really much the Dark Eldar can do about this Eldar presence here. The Wave Serpents are a nightmare to deal with. There's one lone warrior left, and he's going to try and just hold on to the objective there and perhaps fire the Dark Lance at one of the Wave Serpents. Second in command is moving round, and he's going to move in towards the Wraith Lord. If he can bring him down, that'll ratchet up another point for the Dark Eldar. That combat goes on with the jet bikes, and then just here, the Hellions have moved out, and they are on the hunt for the Wraith Lord as well. So, Dark Eldar manoeuvring. I'm going to go on to shooting, see how they do. See if these Hellions can take out this Wraith Lord. Right, so Ben's going to fire these here. Freeze to hit the Wraith Lord. Oh dear. That's horrendous. It falls to wound. Wraith Lord could be in a bit of trouble here. I haven't really seen the Hellions do very well in our games, but they could do well here. 5, 8 saves. If we roll badly, Wraith Lord's dead. It is. It's gone. The Hellions have claimed their first kill. So well done to the Hellions. They've helped bring down the Wraith Knight. It was their hits that did it, and now they've claimed their second victim. The Hellions are giant killers, there's no doubt about it. It's the best we've ever seen them perform. And they've just earned another point for the Dark Eldar force. So, Eldar could be in trouble here. Each side hunting each other's troops down. Suspicious stuff. Right, so shooting for the Dark Eldar on turn 5. This could be the last turn of the game, so it's going to be an important one. These guys are just shuffled around, just staying out of trouble. He can keep his army commander alive, that'd be important. And the Hellions on the hunt with their skyboards moving out across the table have taken out the Wraith Lord. Just a point for the Dark Eldar there. Melee continues. And then coming around, there's no hit from the warrior, and then no damage done from the second in command after that Wraith Lord. So we're going to go on to assaults now for the Dark Eldar. There are a couple of assaults to do, so we'll roll those up. So the combat continues here, and then the Archon has made it into combat. The second in command has found Wraith Lord, and he's going to see if he can take him down. So we're going to roll this up. 6 attacks. He wants freeze to hit. A good roll will destroy the Wraith Lord. That is a good roll. He's got 5 hits. Now 4 pluses. He wants 3 of them. And it's another Wraith Lord brought down. Oh, he's done it by a whisker. The third and final heavy support for the Eldar is dead. The Archon's killed him. The Dark Eldar are good at taking out heavy supports. So the Wraith Lord's gone. Moving on to this final combat here. So Ben will go first with his Reavers. And he is on 8, 9 attacks. 9 attacks, forced to hit. It's a good roll again, very good roll. And then he's going to get to re-roll these wounds, needs 5s. He's got 2. OK, can knock up a few more. Yes, he does. He's good at pulling out the sixes. Now, we've got to pass these on 3+. We don't. We've been wiped out. It's another troop's choice has been knocked down. It is a proper comeback from the Dark Elder. Ben's going to consolidate now. And that it marks the end of those combats. So the Elder have been dealt out some nasty blows towards the end of the game. And it could be that the Dark Elder will turn this around. We could be seeing a classic here. We'll see what happens. Important turn for the Dark Elder on turn 5. We've got to remember the game could end on this turn. So Eldar movement on turn 5, game could end at the end of this turn. So the Rangers have moved down from the top to give them 3 inches of that objective. The Avatar's just tucking in, sort of hiding now because these Hellions are on the hunt for tough units. So just hiding there, then coming around. We've got to deal with these. So the jet bikes have come around, they're going to fire and then use their Eldar jet bike move to try and get on top of that objective. To the rescue is the Crimson Hunter. It's gone around, turn 90 degrees, gone about 24 inches, and then turn 90 degrees again. And it's Vector Dancer special rule. And it's going to lay down some firepower on these jet bikes. Because they're caught out there, they haven't got the turbo boost or the extra jinx save because they've just come out of combat. So they're vulnerable. We'll see if we can bring them down. And then the Fire Dragons should be able to take out that infantry just there. And the two Wave Serpents are going to unload all their firepower and try and take out the two witches. Two remaining witches holding the objective. So Eldar shooting on turn 5. It's been effective, but it was a close run thing. Firepower from the Crimson Hunter took out one of the Reavers. Ben made a load of saves, but he busts morale and has fallen back. So that threat's sort of gone away. And then using our Eldar jet bike move, we've skimmed over on top of the objective. So we're claiming that one, and we're claiming the one in the middle. So the Eldar are definitely winning at this stage. Depends if the game goes on. The Fire Dragons killed the last of the Carbolite Warriors. And then full firepower released from the Wave Serpents just about managed to take out the witches. 25 saves he had to make at 2+, going to ground inside the bunker. And he passed all of them apart from two. So sadly, that unit's been wiped out as well. So the Dark Elder have no troops on the table. And their only hope is to deny the Eldar their objectives. They've got to do something about that. And they have to do something about that. Really, the only hope is the Hellions doing something up through to turn 7 and these guys rallying. Desperate stuff. We're going to roll up now. So Ben's going to roll to see if the game continues. One or two, it's all over. 5, that's it. We're moving on to turn 6. The game is going to move on. So Dark Eldar, turn 6, coming up. Hardly anything left on the table. We'll see what Ben does in a desperate attempt to try and salvage this game. Right, so Dark Elder turn 6. Hellions moving fast on their skyboards, coming round in a position to shoot and assault here. So they're going to take on this Eldar objective, and then coming around the other side, actually being supported by the second in command. He's moving ahead 6 inches, and he's got an opportunity to charge into combat against the Rangers as well. So that Eldar objective is far from secure. It looks like we're going to lose it. Very, very interesting. The army commander's just moving around. He's probably not going to play any part in the game. He's just got to stay alive. He's going to try and keep that bunker safe there and try and stay alive with these wave serpents on the hunt for targets. Then coming around, the Reavers didn't rally and fell back 9 inches. They're still within snap fire range of the jet bikes here. To put it simply, the Dark Elder have to do something about this objective. They've got to deny the troops choices for the Eldar if they're going to stand any chance of winning. So we'll see how the Dark Elder do. Really, they need to get into turn 7 to win the game. To stand any chance of winning the game. So Dark Elder shooting coming up on turn 6. So shooting for the Dark Elder on turn 6. Hellions firing through, a lot of hits, but a 2-up save for these scouts here. The Rangers, so they've all been saved. There's no damage there, and then the Reavers snap firing at the jet bikes, haven't done any damage. So it's going to be combat, so they're going to decide this. And he's thinking of how he's going to deal with the Rangers and take on that Avatar as well. It's going to be a tough one. But he fancies the second in command, the Archon, having some chance at bringing that Avatar down. If he does that, incredible. So we're going to move on to assaults now for the Dark Elder on turn 6. Alright, so the Hellions have made it in just about. They've got 4 inches on their roll, and the second in command is just on the other side of that doorway. So the Rangers are being swamped here. The Avatar's been ignored. So their priority is to take out their troops. So the Eldar objective here, which we thought was safe, has now been swamped by the remnants of the Dark Elder force. So they've eliminated one objective, it seems. That's what's going to happen. And then the emphasis in turn 7, if we go on to it, will be over here. So we'll get this combat done. See how it goes. So the Avatar's wondering what on earth's happened to his Rangers. And it's just seen a whole load of Dark Elder piling out of the entrance there. The Eldar troops have gone. The Avatar's isolated now his own. So they've consolidated a couple of inches back with these. And then a couple of inches, well, 4 inches, moving through the doorway. The second in command bursts through. So the Rangers have been gone, brought down in style. So that's one objective cleared for the Dark Elder. So you've got Eldar turn 6 coming up now. They just need to secure an objective and counter the Dark Elder, and they should win the game. If it goes on to turn 7, it'll be hard to know what will happen. Alright, so Eldar movement on turn 6 again. It could be the last turn of the game. The Avatar on his own. He's going to take on the Hellions, so he's moved out from his position there. That's the threat to get rid of. And then the Crimson Hunter, using its maneuverability, has swung around just to lend a bit of fire support. And it does have that precision shot special rule, so we'll see if we can take out the Heliarch there. That'd be a nasty surprise for the Dark Elder there. Just holding the objective, just shifted a little bit just to get our Jink save. And then coming around, Fire Dragons are out of the game really, just sitting there. But the two Wave Serpents are on the move, they've moved up 12 inches and heading towards the Reavers. So shooting now for the Dark Elder, we'll see what we can do. See if we can reduce these Hellions down, and that should spoil the game for the Dark Elder and extinguish any hopes of trying to win the game. Right, so shooting for the Eldar, fire support from the Crimson Hunter coming down, and the Avatar took out two of the Hellions, and they've busted morale and have fallen back 10 inches. So it's a shame, but that unit's been knocked out. That may well secure it for the Eldar there. And then the Wave Serpents have moved up and around. They've gone 18 inches across, just moving into position for potential turn 7. So the Avatar now, he's got no one to charge, he's just going to sit there. And if we go on to turn 7, then the Dark Elder Archon may well take him on in combat. Ben's going to roll for another turn. On a 4 or more, we're going to turn 7. No, the game is over. It's been a long one. And we'll calculate results here, but it looks like the Eldar have snatched victory. at the end. But it was a close run thing and a very enjoyable one. We know the Dark Eldar have work to be done. I mean, the Eldar here are a refined force, been changing this force around for a long, long time. Dark Eldar are new and inexperienced, so we know there's changes to be made, but they've given a good account of themselves here in this game. So just calculating points here. The Dark Eldar haven't got Linebreaker, they haven't slain the Warlord. But they have killed three heavy supports, the two Wraith Lords and the Wraith Knight were taken out. So 3 points for the Dark Eldar there. Eldar are holding an objective, 3 points. And they got First Blood, that's 4. And they killed two heavy supports for the Dark Eldar. That makes it 6 points. And they've got Linebreaker. The Fire Dragons are claiming the Linebreaker point. So that's 7-3. Good win. But it wasn't easy by any means, and a real scare towards the end as the Dark Eldar pushed ahead with more mobile units. So it's a good game, very enjoyable game. We look forward to playing this again, and perhaps you'll see a refined and upgraded Dark Eldar army in the future. So thanks for watching, and tune in next time.